statement of the Taylor's theorem. Here, look at this. If a function fx of real variable x, Taylor's theorem is also available for complex numbers, but here we will only consider the functions of real variables. So here, if a function fx of real variable x be such that, number one, fx f dash x first order derivative up to fn minus 1 x, n minus 1th order derivative of x are continuous in a closed interval AB, and the nth derivative exists in the open interval AB, remember this, open interval AB, then there exists at least one value of x, say x equal to xi lies between a less than x less than b, that is in the open interval, such that FB, the interval AB, FB equal to FA, B minus A, F dash A, F1A, B minus A whole square by 2 factorial, F2A, second order derivative, plus dot dot dot, N minus 1 order derivative, and the last term is B minus A whole to the power N, factorial N, Fn j. That's why it is considered that in the open interval, nth order derivative in xi means it is xi lies between a, b. So, if it is nth order derivative exists in the open interval a, b, that is enough for the Taylor's theorem for the nth order derivative. But remaining derivative must be exist in the.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Sir, can you please restart this?
Which one?
Taylor's theorem.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So here we will consider a function of real variables that I have mentioned that it is Taylor's theorem also available for the complex numbers. But here we will consider only for the function of real variables. Now, if two conditions are satisfied by the function. Number one, if the function fx and its up to n minus 1 derivatives, that is f1x, f2x, up to fn minus 1x are all continuous in the closed interval AB and the nth order derivative exists in the open interval AB. So, for the last derivative, it may be in the open, its existence may be in the open interval. Why? That I discussed in these expressions. I will again discuss. In that case, if there exist at least in that case, if these two conditions are satisfied, then there exists at least one value of x that I have mentioned in that Rolle's theorem, Lagrange's mean value theorem, Cauchy's mean value theorem, that there exists at least one value of x, say x equal to xi, lies in the open interval AB such that this FB equal to FA plus B minus A, F1A, B minus A whole square by 2 factorial F2A plus dot 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 up to Fn minus 1A. And the last term is, look at this, B minus A whole to the power n by n factorial fn xi. This xi lies between open interval AB. So that's why the nth order derivative, if it exists in the open interval, then also there is no problem. But for the other derivatives, it must lie in the closed interval. Okay, this is the statement of the Taylor's theorem. So, if the question is state the Taylor's theorem for the function of real variable, then up to this is enough. But we can derive several things from the Taylor's theorem. Now look at this. If b equal to a plus h, that I have considered in Lagrange's and Cauchy's mean value theorem also, that is here we have considered interval AB. Instead of AB, if we take A and A plus H, that is the length of the interval H, then this form takes another form. Look at this. it is nothing. All are the same, equivalent, because B is replaced by A plus H. So it is takes the form FA, H, F1A, HA square by 2 factorial F2A, and so on. And the last term is, look at this, H to the power N, N factorial FN, A plus theta H. Same thing that I have mentioned, Lagrange's and Cauchy's form. This, because here j equal to A plus theta H. This A plus theta H lies between A and A plus H, since theta lies between 0 and 1. Theta varies from 0, 1. So the point A plus theta H lies between A and A plus H. This is another form. So if nothing is mentioned, only the question is state the Taylor's theorem, then you can take this form, you can take the earlier form in the interval AB, you can take this form in the interval AA plus HB, no problem, any one is enough. But why the second form is also important? Sometimes to solve examples, we mainly use the second one. That's why it is also the same form. All are same form. Okay, next two things are very important. The remainder after n terms. Look at this. How many terms are there in that expansion of the Taylor's theorem? N plus 1 number of terms. So the last term, that is remainder after n terms, that is denoted by Rn. And here look at this. Remainder after n terms in A, here B minus A whole to the power n by n factorial Fn j. This is the remainder after n terms. And if you consider the second form, h to the power n by n factorial Fn A plus theta h, this is the remainder after n terms. Both are same. This is denoted by Rn, and this form is called the Lagrange's form of the remainder. Lagrange's form of the remainder. So there are, remember in this way, there are n plus 1 number of terms. Last term, that is remainder, last term is called the remainder, and this is the remainder after n terms. And this is either the Rn equal to B minus A whole to the power n by n factorial Fn j, or H to the power, both are same. And these forms are the remainder after n terms. And these either the first one or second one, these are the remainder in Lagrange's form. Why I am mentioning Lagrange's form? Next one is Cauchy's form. I will discuss it later. Why these are so important? So remainder after n terms, these are Lagrange's form of remainder. And the second and the next line, look at this, writing Rn equal to h to the power n 1 minus theta. Rn equal to h to the power n 1 minus theta whole to the power n minus 1 by n minus 1 factorial Fn a plus theta h. Here also look at this, 0 less than theta less than 1, called the Cauchy's form of remainder after n terms. So if the question is state Taylor's theorem, then any form is enough. If the question is state Taylor's theorem with Lagrange's form of remainder, then the first two that I have discussed, it is enough. If the question is state Taylor's theorem with Cauchy's form of remainder, then you have to write the last form, that Rn equal to h to the power n, a 1 minus theta whole to the power n minus 1 by n minus 1 factorial Fn a plus theta h. You have to write the last term is in this form if the question is state Taylor's theorem with Cauchy's form of remainder. So there are two forms of remainder. One is Lagrange's form and the second one is Cauchy's form.
Sir,
Yes.
Sir, how did Cauchy's form come?
Cauchy's form and Lagrange's form, whenever I will go to the proof, I will consider it that the first one. Your question is that how we will get this form, or why it is Lagrange's and Cauchy's form?
How we'll get that?
That is I will discuss now.
Okay, sir. Okay.
In the proof. Proof is also given here.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Okay. Proof of Taylor's theorem with Lagrange's form of remainder. Okay. The first one, that if your question is state and proof Taylor's theorem with Lagrange's proof of remainder, form of remainder, then you have to state the Taylor's theorem with Lagrange's form of remainder, and your proof is this one. One. This is, look at this, proof one. Proof of the Taylor's theorem with Lagrange's form of remainder. Here, as we have considered it for the Lagrange's mean value theorem, Cauchy's mean value theorem, what we have done, we have considered from another new functions from the given functions, and then we have chosen the constant in such a way that all the three conditions of Rolle's theorem satisfied. So then we have established the theorem. Here also, look at this, let us construct a new function. So trend is almost similar for Lagrange's, Cauchy's and Taylor's theorem. Look at this, phi x is the new function, and this new function is taken in this form, fx, a plus h minus x, f1x, a plus h minus x whole square by 2 factorial f2x. You may write f2, f double, whatever you comfortable, you may write, no problem. Okay, then a plus h plus dot dot dot, not the next term is to the power n minus 1. Here there are some terms, and then plus dot 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 plus a plus h minus x whole to the power n minus 1 by n minus 1 factorial f n minus 1 x plus, look at the, this is the last term, a plus h minus x whole to the power n into capital F. This is the new function constructed based on the given function and its derivative. So again, the same thing, we will choose the constant A in such a way that phi A plus H equal to phi A. Phi A plus H equal to phi A. The same thing we have done for Lagrange's and Cauchy's mean value theorem. Okay, from here, phi a plus h equal to phi a. So if you substitute phi a plus h, then it takes the form like 3. Okay, then its derivative phi dash x, it is also exist. Why? Because derivative of fx exists, so phi dash x exists. And look at this, after differentiating phi x, that is phi dash x, if you check all the terms, find that first term is f1x, second term is minus f1x, so these two terms are cancelled. Similarly, third term a plus h minus x, f double dash x, minus a h minus x, f double dash x. So these terms are also cancelled. In this way, finally, we will get the equation in the relation 4. Look at this, a plus h minus x whole to the power n minus 1 by n minus 1 factorial into fn x minus n factorial a. This is number 4. So now, from the 1, 4 and 2 and the given condition, we see that phi x satisfies all the conditions of the Rolle's theorem. That is, it is continuous in the closed interval AB, a derivative exists in the open interval AB, AB or A plus H, that whatever you take. and its derivative exist. And then what? Then there exist at least one value. If you take a plus h, that is a plus theta h, phi dash a plus theta h equal to 0. Now phi dash x equal to what? Given in 4. So phi dash theta h equal to, you will get this one. So since h not equal to 0, 1 minus theta not equal to 0, theta lies between 0 and 1, so 1 minus theta not equal to 0. Of course h not equal to 0, otherwise what will happen? The same point a, you will not get an interval. So a is this, a equal to what? Fn a plus theta h by n factorial. This is a. Okay, now from 3 and 5, f a plus h equal to this one, and substitute a in the last term. So you will get from 3 and 5, you will get f a plus h equal to f a plus h f dash a plus h square by 2 factorial. In this way, the last term is f to the power n by n factorial fn a plus theta h. This last term is the remainder, and this is known as the Lagrange's form of remainder, because this remainder is determined by the Lagrange. That's why its name is Lagrange's form of remainder. So the most important thing is the choice of the new function phi x. You have to remember this one. If your choice of the second new function phi x is this, then it is nothing. Same thing of the Rolle's theorem. It is continuous in the closed interval. It's after finding its derivative, you will look that the derivative also exists in the open interval. And we choose a capital A, the unknown constant, in such a way that the phi a plus a is equal to phi a. So all the three conditions of Rolle's theorem are satisfied. Therefore, there exists at least one value of x lies between a and a plus h. Here, if you take a and a plus h, the at least one value means it will be a plus theta h, at which the phi dash is 0. So all these relations, you will get the Taylor's theorem with Lagrange's form of remainder. Now you asked me that how you will get Taylor's Lagrange's form and how you will get Cauchy's form. So Lagrange's form is found from here, that if you choose the function phi x is here. Look at this in the relation one, a plus h minus x whole to the power n into a. If your choice the last term is this, you will get a term in the Taylor's theorem, last term, that term is the Lagrange's form of remainder. Now come to the second proof means for Cauchy's form of remainder. Look at this come to here, proof of Taylor's theorem with Cauchy's form of remainder. Here also you have to take a new function, construct a new function phi x. Look at this, almost the same, all the terms are same except the last one. What is the difference between the earlier phi x and this phi x? We have chosen phi x earlier also to prove the Taylor's theorem with Lagrange's form of remainder. Here also we have chosen phi x to prove the Taylor's theorem with Cauchy's form of remainder. But what is the difference in constructing the function phi x in case of 1 and case of 2? What is the difference?
Last term.
Look at this. Here last term is a plus h minus x, and here it is, look at this, a plus h minus x whole to the power n. This is the difference. If you if you choose the last term is a plus h minus x whole to the power n into a, then you will get the Taylor's theorem. The last term is Lagrange's form of remainder. If you choose the phi x, remaining terms are same, only the last term a plus h minus x into a. That is, here we have not taken to the power n. Here also you will get the Taylor's theorem, the remaining terms are same except the last term. Last term will take the form this h to the power n, 1 minus theta to the power n minus 1, n minus 1 factorial fn a plus theta h. And this form is known as the Cauchy's form of remainder. This form is derived by Cauchy, and the last form that I have discussed earlier derived by Lagrange. That's why they are based on their name. It is known as the Cauchy's form of remainder, and earlier one is the Lagrange's form of remainder. I am not discussing much more about this Cauchy's form of remainder, because the same thing, you have to choose a capital A in such a way that phi a plus h equal to phi a, and its derivative is this. Then all the satisfies all the three conditions of Rolle's theorem. Therefore, phi dash a plus theta h equal to 0. From here, you will get a, and a, then substitute in f a plus h equal to this, you will get the Taylor's theorem with Cauchy's form of remainder. But what you have to do, you have to prove this by yourself, because there are several terms. If you just know the fact that we have to construct the function phi x in this way, that is enough, but still you have to practice. Otherwise, there are several terms. If you mistake one term, your results will be different. Okay, so this is the Taylor's theorem with finite number of terms. If the question is Taylor's theorem, you will understand that it is Taylor's theorem with finite number of terms, actually n plus 1 number of terms. Last term is the remainder. That this may be Lagrange's form, this may be Cauchy's form. If only the statement, question is only state the Taylor's theorem, then you don't have to prove, just write the statement. And if it is mention nothing, then it is better to write the last term as Rn, where Rn equal to this in Lagrange's form and Rn equal to this in Cauchy's form. Then you will get full marks, because no remainder is mentioned. You have to mention both. But if it is mentioned Lagrange's form of remainder, then write only the Lagrange's form of remainder. Cauchy's form of remainder, then write only the Cauchy's form of remainder. Remember this one. Okay, next one is the Maclaurin's theorem. Maclaurin's theorem is a particular case of Taylor's theorem. It is not totally different. Only it is a special case of the Taylor's theorem. How? Look at this. In Taylor's theorem, if we put a equal to 0 and h equal to x, that is, your interval is a plus h. Now, if you substitute a equal to 0, then the first point is 0 and the a plus h, a 0, that is only h, and h is taken as x, the interval is 0x. So in Taylor's theorem, if we put a equal to 0 and h equal to x, we get the corresponding Maclaurin's theorem. So it is not different from Taylor's theorem. It is a particular case of the Taylor's theorem. So the Maclaurin's theorem is, if you know the statement of Taylor's theorem, it is nothing, just substitute a equal to 0 and h equal to x. In the left hand side it is f a plus h, so left hand side fx. Here it is, the first term is f a is taken as 0, so f 0, x f dash 0 x square by 2 factorial f double dash 0 plus dot 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 plus this plus rn. This rn is the remainder after n terms. You may take it Lagrange's form, you may take it in Cauchy's form. So if you take it Lagrange's form, then its form is x to the power n by n factorial fn theta x. Just substitute a equal to 0, h equal to x. And if you take the Cauchy's form of remainder, then the remainder after n terms is rn equal to x to the power n 1 minus theta whole to the power n minus 1 by n minus 1 factorial fn theta x. This is also derived by just substituting a equal to 0 and h equal to x. So if you consider the Maclaurin's theorem, it is nothing but a Taylor's theorem with a particular value, with a particular situation rather. Here if you substitute a equal to 0 and h equal to x, you will get the Maclaurin's theorem. Sometimes Maclaurin's theorem is mostly used to expand the function. So for example, expand the function fx equal to sin x in powers of x, then you have to use the Maclaurin's theorem. Fx equal to sin x and right hand side f0 x f dash 0, that is derivative of sin x at x equal to 0. Next term is x square by 2 factorial f double dash 0, that is the second derivative of sin x, then at x equal to 0. In this way you will get the expansion of the sin x for n plus 1 number of terms. So Taylor's theorem with two forms of remainder, Maclaurin's theorem with two forms of remainder. Yes. Okay. I will solve one, two example, then I will state the condition under which this finite number of terms can be extended to infinite number of terms. One example is taken here as a to the power x, fx equal to a to the power x. Not remainder is written, remainder is written here, but here I think there is a mistake. The last term is not written here. X to the power n minus 1 by n minus 1 factorial log a whole to the power n minus 1 plus rn. This rn is written in the proof, but not written here. You write in your note that a to the power x equal to 1 plus x log a plus this plus dot 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 plus the last term, this x to the power n by n factorial a to the power theta x log a whole to the power n. Yeah, right here in the question. In the question, page number 5. So you have to use the Taylor's theorem. Fx equal to a to the power x, f dash x equal to e to the power x log a, fr x a to the power x log a to the power r, and fr theta x, why is essential? Because for the last term, remainder after n terms. So if you remember this form, fx equal to this, then it is nothing. Just what you have to do, fx equal to a to the power x, then what you have to do, first derivative, second derivative, n minus 1 derivative, nth derivative, and then substitute there. So here also first derivative, second derivative, rth derivative, and finally if you substitute here with the, in the last term x is replaced by theta x in the last term. Here in the given example, look at this rn fn theta x. So you will get the expansion of a to the power x using Taylor's theorem. Taylor's theorem means here actually we are using Maclaurin's theorem. Maclaurin's theorem with Taylor's theorem with a equal to 0 and h equal to x. This is one example. And next one is the here look at this. Here it is mentioned remainder in Lagrange's form. Expand fx equal to cos x in power of x with a remainder in Lagrange's form. So first you have to write the Maclaurin's series, and accordingly you need to differentiate fx equal to cos x and then substitute in the expansion. Fx equal to cos x, f dash x minus sin x, f double dash x minus cos x, and already in the beginning of the successive differentiation I have told you that some special function, nth derivative of some special function, you have to remember. So fn x equal to what? Cos n pi by 2 plus x. So all these are found at x equal to 0 and only the last term, and then substitute in the expansion of the Maclaurin's theorem, you will get the result. And the next example, look at this, find the Cauchy's form of remainder. So you have to also remember all the expansion and also the two forms, Cauchy's form, Lagrange's form. Because here the Cauchy's only mention the Cauchy's form of remainder, but remainder is not given. So you have to remember, then differentiate the function, then substitute, you will get the expansion with Cauchy's form of remainder. Log of 1 plus x, fn x equal to, no, also I have mentioned in the successive differentiation what will be the nth order derivative of log of 1 plus x, this is, and then substitute in the expansion of Maclaurin's series with Cauchy's form of remainder, you will get this one. Sometimes your question may be not the expansion, only find the Cauchy's form of remainder, only write the Lagrange's form of remainder, then you have to find the nth order derivative and substitute the form, either x to the power n, n factorial fn theta x, or the Cauchy's form, x to the power n 1 minus theta whole to the power n minus 1 by n minus 1 factorial fn theta x, and substitute the nth order derivative with x is replaced to be by theta x. And several times I have mentioned that you have to also mention 0 less than theta less than 1, otherwise it will be meaningless, because theta x must lie between 0 and x. That's why you have to mention this one. Some more examples are also given. Apply Maclaurin's theorem to fx equal to 1 plus x to the power 4. You have to prove that 1 plus x to the power 4 equal to this. You can do it by yourself using the other theory, 1 plus x whole square, then again 1 plus whole square of that, you can find this one, or by other things like NC1x, NC2, like that. But here it is mentioned, apply Maclaurin's theorem to fx equal to this, means you have to apply Maclaurin's theorem. So you have to remember the statement. It will be very much clear to you that this is the Maclaurin series expansion, and I have to find these derivatives, then I have to substitute there, that is enough. Just find the derivative, substitute, because here it is, look at this, 1 plus x to the power whole to the power 4, so fifth order derivative will be 0, so you don't have to do much more derivative of this function and you will get this one. Okay, just I told you that I will leave little early, but I will just mention how you will extend the Taylor's theorem for the infinite number of terms. Taylor's series extended to infinity. So far I have discussed only the finite number of terms, both Taylor's and Maclaurin's. Maclaurin's is nothing, it is a particular case of Taylor's theorem. But how you will extend up to infinity? This is very important. If in Taylor series Rn tends to 0 as n tends to infinity, then the series can be extended to infinity. So what is the condition? The remainder after n terms tends to 0 as n tends to infinity. Remainder after n terms tends to 0. So if you would like to extend to infinite number of terms, first you have to check whether Rn, the remainder after n terms, whether it is, you may take Lagrange's form. If it is easier to you to show that Rn tends to 0, you may use the Cauchy's form. If you think it is easier to show that Rn tends to 0 as n tends to infinity, it does not matter, but you have to show that Rn tends to 0 as n tends to infinity. Then the series can be extended to infinity. So suppose this is the, in that case, the if you consider that it is fx plus h, then fx, hf dash x, h square by 2 factorial f double dash x plus dot dot dot. In Taylor's theorem, we conclude up to n plus 1 number of terms, that is up to n plus 1 number of terms, but if Rn tends to 0, then we can extend to any number of terms. In Maclaurin's infinite series, fx equal to f0 xf dash 0 plus dot dot dot, we finished with n plus 1 number of terms. Here, if Rn tends to 0, this can be extended to infinity. But so one condition you must remember, that Taylor's theorem can be extended to infinite number of terms provided Rn, the remainder after n terms, tends to 0. Okay, just I will show one example. Expand sin x in power of x in infinite series. So here look at this, fx equal to sin x, fn x equal to sin n pi by 2 plus x. So fn 0 equal to sin n pi by 2, which is 0 or plus minus, I am not going there. You know sin n pi by 2 is what? 0 or plus minus 1 according as n is even or not. Now Rn, Rn equal to what? If you consider the Maclaurin's theorem, x to the power n by n factorial fn theta x. This is Rn for Lagrange's form of remainder. Now fn theta x is what? Fn theta x mean n pi by 2 plus theta x. Now Rn, if Rn tends to 0 as n tends to infinity, then you can extend it to infinite number of terms. So Rn equal to x to the power n by n factorial sin nx n pi by 2 plus theta x. You know that mod of sin x less than equal to 1. So Rn less than equal to x to the power n by n factorial. And Rn tends to 0 here as n tends to infinity, since you know that x to the power n by n factorial tends to 0 as n tends to infinity for all values of x. So here you can extend it to infinity. You can extend to infinity. Why? Rn tends to 0. So your expansion will be fx equal to f0 plus x f dash 0 plus x square by 2 factorial f double dash 0 plus x cube by 3 factorial f triple dash 0 dot 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 to infinity. You may ask that how many terms you will write. Usually we write 3, 4 maximum 4 terms. That is enough because you will not differentiate sin x 100 terms, 200 terms, 300 terms, because there are infinite number of terms. So first 3, 4 terms is enough. So you will get x sin x equal to x minus x cube by 3 factorial, x to the power 5 by 5 factorial minus this. This is already, it is known to you. And if you use Maclaurin's theorem, then if you substitute all the derivatives and simplify, you will get sin x equal to this. The same expansion that already it is known to you. Okay. Some more examples are given. You may check. Then I will discuss, and next I will, after solving some more examples, then I will start the application. That is, two applications are there. One is the curvature and another application is the asymptote. Asymptotes of curves. Curvature, curves. Two applications I will solve. Some theorems and examples. But before that, you may try these examples. Not so difficult. Just differentiate functions and substitute to the given expansion. You will get the. And in case of infinite number of terms, infinite series, then you have to show that R n tends to 0 as n tends to infinity. Okay.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, do we need to practice the proofs for exams or only to practice problem solving?
For Taylor's theorem?
Yes, sir. And others, previous theorems?
No. If I give here the proof, then it you know that it is also for your exam purpose, because I have discussed the proof of Leibniz theorem, means it is also useful for your exam purpose. I have not given the statement proof of Rolle's theorem, so it is not essential for your exam purpose. I have discussed proof of Lagrange's theorem, proof of Cauchy mean value theorem, proof of Taylor's theorem. So it means these are also important for your exam purpose.
Sir, okay. From where to practice question?
Some books are written in your syllabus also. You can check from there.
Okay, sir.
And also I will send you all documents. You can. If you need more examples, I can send you. Also, you can get from those books also, you can try. Okay. So, that's enough. Okay, so I will leave now.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.